There is one Inanna myth in which a mortal plays an important role. Its plot runs thus. Once upon a time, there lived a gardener named Shukalida, whose diligent efforts at gardening had met with nothing but failure. Although he had carefully watered his furrows and garden patches, the plants had withered away. The raging wind smote his face with the dust of the mountains. All that he had carefully tended turned desolate. He thereupon lifted his eyes east and west to the starry heavens, studied the omens, observed and learned the divine decrees. Because of this newly gained wisdom, he planted the as yet unidentified Sabatu tree in the garden, a tree whose broad shades last from sunrise to sunset. Because of this ancient horticultural experiment, Shukalatuda's garden blossomed forth with all kinds of green. One day continues our myth. After traversing heaven and earth, the goddess Inanna laid down to rest her tired body near to Shukalatuda's garden. The latter, who had spied her from the edge of his garden, takes advantage of Inanna's weariness and cohabits with her. When morning came and the sun rose, Inanna looked about her in consternation and determined to ferret out all costs the mortal who had so shamefully disliked her. She therefore sends three plagues against Sumer. First, she fills all the land wells with blood, to have all the palm groves and vineyards saturated with blood. Second, she sends against the land destructive winds and storms. The nature of the third plague is uncertain, since the relevant lines are too fragmentary. Despite all three plagues, she cannot locate her defiler. For after each plague, Shukalatuda goes to his father's house and informs him of his danger. The father advises his son to direct his step to his brothers, the Igigi, that is the people of Sumer, and to stay close to the urban centers. Shukalatuda follows this advice, and as a result, Inanna cannot find him. After the third failure, Inanna realizes bitterly that she cannot avenge the outrage committed against her. Therefore, she goes to the city of Eridu, to the house of Enki, the Sumerian god of wisdom, and asks for his advice and help. Unfortunately, the tablet breaks off, and the story's ending remains unknown. Except for references to humankind, mortals play a minor role in the Sumerian myths. Besides the Inanna, Shukalatuda myth just described, only one myth involves a mortal. This is the long-known flood story, so crucial for comparative biblical studies. Unfortunately, only instability inscribed with this myth has been excavated to date, and this tablet is only one-third preserved. The beginning of the myth is broken away, and the first intelligible lines concern the creation of man, vegetation, and animals, the heavenly origin of kingship, the founding and naming of five antediluvian cities, which are presented to five tutelary deities. We then learn that several deities are bitter and unhappy because of a divine decision to bring the flood and destroy humankind. Zerusudra, the Sumerian counterpart of the biblical Noah, is next introduced in the story as a pious God-fearing king who's constantly looking for divine dreams and revelations. He stations himself by a wall where he hears the voice of a deity, probably Enki, informing him of the decision taken by the assembly of the gods to send a deluge and destroy the seed of humanity. The myth must have continued with detailed instructions to Zerusudra to build a giant boat and thus save himself from destruction. All this is missing because of a rather large break in the tablet. When the text resumes, we find that the flood in all its violence had already come upon the earth, where it raged for 7 days and nights. Following this, the sun god Utu comes forth, lighting and warming up the earth, and Zusutra prostrates himself before him and offers him sacrifices of oxen and sheep. The last extant lines of the myth describe the deification of Zusutra. After he had prostrated himself before Anun Enlil, he was given life like a god and translated to Dulmun, the divine paradise land, the place where the sun rises. Finally, there is a Sumerian myth which, although concerned with gods only, provides an exciting bit of anthropological information about the Semitic Bedou people, known as Matu. The story's action takes place in Inup, the city of cities, the land of princeship, a still unknown locality in Mesopotamia. Its tutelary deity seems to have been Matu, god of the nomadic Semites who lived to the west and southwest of Sumer. The relative time when the events took place is described in cryptic, antithetical, and obscure phrases. Thus, Ninub existed, Aktub existed not. The Holy Crown existed, the Holy Tiara existed not. The Holy Herbs existed, Holy Nitrum existed not. The god Matu, the story begins, marries. Ile asks his mother to take him a wife, but she advises him to find a wife for himself following his desire. One day, the story continues, a grand feast is prepared in Ninub, and to it comes Nemushta, the tutelary deity of Kazalu, a city-state located to the northeast of Sumer, together with his wife and daughter. During this feast, Matu performs some heroic deed that brings joy to the hearts of Nemushta. As a reward, the latter offers Matu silver and lapis lazuli. Matu refuses. It is the hand of Nemushtu's daughter, which he claims is a reward. Nemushta gladly consents, so too does his daughter, although her girlfriends try to dissuade her from marrying Matu since he lives in tents, buffeted by wind and rain, eats uncooked meat, has no house while he lives, he is not brought to burial when he dies. The myths of the Akkadians, that is, of the Mesopotamians and Assyrians, derive primarily from Sumerian prototypes. At least two of them, Ishtar's descent to the netherworld and the flood, story is told in the epic of Gilgamesh, are well nigh identical with known Sumerian originals. Even those for which no Sumerian counterparts have yet been recovered contain mythological themes and motifs that reflect Sumerian sources, not to mention that most of the deities involved are part of the Sumerian pantheon. The Akkadian poets imitated their Sumerian prototypes slavishly. They introduced many innovations and changes in both theme and plot. The Akkadian men of letters could not escape the profound and all-pervading influence of their Sumerian heritage. The best known of the Akkadian myths is the creation poem, usually called Enuma Elish, from its initial two words, when above. The poem was composed not so much to tell the story of creation, but to glorify the Babylonian god Marduk and the city of Babylon. It introduces and relates Marduk's acts of creation and is thus a prime source of the Akkadian cosmogonic ideas. Thus, the poem tells us that at the very beginning, when as yet the heavens had not been named on high and the earth had not been called by name below, there were only the primordial oceans, Tiamat and Apsu, the Sumerian Abzu. Then, several generations of gods were born at some specified time, the Sumerian Enki, the god of wisdom. These gods, however, distressed Apsu and Tiamat with their unceasing bustle and clamor, and Apsu did away with them, although his wife Tiamat urged him to have compassion on them. Then, to free the gods from menial labor, Marduk, with the help of his father E, created mankind from the blood of King U, the rebel god who'd been the leader of Tiamat's inimical host. Fortunately for the gods, however, E killed Apsu with the help of a magic incantation. E then established his abode upon the dead Apsu, and there his wife gave birth to Marduk, a heroic and imposing figure of a god who soon had to show his bravery by saving the gods from Tiamat, bent on avenging the death of her husband Apsu with the help of some renegade gods and a host of vicious monsters. Following this victory, Marduk created heaven and earth from Tiamat's giant corpse by splitting it in two. He then created unique stations for the gods, set up the stellar constellations, constructed gates through which the sun might enter and depart, and caused the moon to shine forth. Following this, the appreciative gods built the Sigilla, Marduk's temple at Babylon, prepared a joyous banquet and recited Marduk's 50 names, which attributed all the major gods' powers to Akkadian pantheon. Besides the Enuma-Elish version, several other and much briefer creation accounts differ in many details from each other and from that of Enuma-Elish. Thus, there is one account used as an introduction to an incantation for the purification of a Babylonian temple, which relates that, at first, nothing existed, neither reed nor tree, neither house nor temple, neither city nor living creatures, and that all lands were sea. Then, the gods were created and Babylon was built, after which Marduk fashioned a reed frame over the face of the waters and created humankind with the help of the mother goddess, Aruru, the Sumerian Ninmar alias Nintu alias Ninhursag. Following the man, Marduk created the beasts of the plain, the rivers Tigris and Euphrates. Furthermore, dry land came into being and cities such as Nippur and Erech, together with their temples and houses, were built of bricks fashioned in brick molds. According to another brief creation account, one that was intended for recitation in connection with a ritual for the restoration of a temple, it was the god Anu, the Sumerian heaven god An, who created the heavens, while E, the Sumerian Enki, created the dry land and everything on it. He pinched off clay from over his sea dwelling, the Apsu, and created the brick god Kala. He created the reed marshes, forests, mountains, and seas, and the gods oversaw such crafts as carpentry, metalwork, engraving, and stone cutting. In order that the temples, once built, might be provided with regular offerings, he created the deities in charge of grain, cattle, and wine, as well as a divine cook, cupbearer, and high priest. Finally, to maintain the temples and perform the labor that the gods would otherwise have to do themselves, they created men and kings. There is a fragmentary creation myth used as an introduction to a childbirth incantation, of which only the passage dealing with the creation of man is preserved. According to this version, the gods turn to Mummy, alias Aruru, the mother goddess, also known by her Sumerian names Nintu, Ninhursag, and Ninmar, with a request to create man to bear the yoke of the gods. Mummy asks Enki for counsel, and he advises Mummy to fashion man as a partly divine creature by mirroring clay of a deity slain by the gods. There is one creation poem devoted primarily to the creation of man alone. This version begins with the statement that, after heaven had been separated from earth, and the earth had been fashioned after the fate of the universe had been decreed, and the Tigris and Euphrates together with their dikes and canals had been established, and given their proper direction, then all the gods seated themselves in their sacred sanctuary, and Enlil, the king of the gods, asks, "Now that the fate of the universe has been decreed, dike and canal have been given proper direction, the banks of the Tigris and Euphrates have been established, what shall we do? What else shall we create? O Anunnaki, great gods, what else shall we do? What else shall we create?" The Anunnaki thereupon urges Enlil that the gods create man out of the blood of two Lamga, artisan gods, whom they will slay for this purpose. Man's portion, the gods continue, will be to carry out the service of the gods for all time by tiling and irrigating the fields and building temples and sanctuaries for them. Accordingly, created two mortals with the names Ulegara and Zalagara, two Sumerian words whose meaning is still uncertain, and the gods blessed these with generous increase and rich abundance so that they might celebrate the festivals of the gods day and night. According to the Akkadian Medic practitioners, how the Akkadian poets felt free to change the existing cosmogonic ideas following the need of the moment is beautifully illustrated by a creation version used as an incantation against toothache. According to the Akkadian Medic practitioners, this was because of a blood-sucking worm lodged in the gums. As the author, who was a poet, priest, and physician combined, puts it, "After Anu had created heaven, heaven had created earth. Earth had created rivers. Rivers had created canals. Canals had created marsh. Marsh had created worm. The worm came weeping before Shamash." The text closes with instructions to the dentist incantation to insert the needle and seize its, the worm's, foot. Presumably, to pull the sick nerve and to perform an accompanying ritual involving the mixing of second-grade beans and oils. Among the non-cosmogonic myths, one tells of the slaying of the giant sea-born monster Lub, who brought havoc and destruction to the people and their cities. Another myth revolves around the slaying of the monstrous zoo bird, who, in its inordinate lust for power, stole the tablets of fate right from under Enlil's nose, and thus usurped the sovereignty over the gods. The plot motif of the two stories is similar. Several deities ordered to do battle with the monsters decline the honor in cowardly terror, despite the promised reward. Then one courageous deity, probably Marduk or Ninurta, agrees, slays the monster, and is rewarded accordingly. One myth concerns the netherworld and relates how the god Nergal, originally a sky god, became king of Hades, where until then the goddess Ereshkigal had reigned supreme. The story begins with an invitation by the gods to Ereshkigal, queen of the netherworld, to send a representative to a banquet which they had prepared since she cannot leave her dominion. Ereshkigal accepts and sends Namtar, fate, the demon of death. Namtar arrives in heaven and is welcomed with due honor by the gods, except for Nergal, who insults him by remaining seated when all the gods rise to greet him. To avenge this insult, Ereshkigal demands that Nergal be extradited to the netherworld, where she will put him to death. On the plea of Nergal, however, the god Enki comes to his rescue by giving him 14 demons to accompany him to the netherworld and stand by him against Ereshkigal. Upon arrival in Hades, Nergal posted the 14 demons at its 14 gate, while he, after being admitted by the gatekeeper of the netherworld, rushed into Ereshkigal's palace, dragged her from the throne by her hair, and was all set to cut off her head. She tearfully pleaded with him not to take her, become her husband instead, and take dominion over Hades, whereupon Nergal kissed her, wiped away her tears, and agreed to become lord and king of the netherworld with Ereshkigal as his lady and queen. There are three mythological compositions in which mortals play a significant role. In one of these, the protagonist is a sage of Eridu by the name of Adapa, who might have secured eternal use for himself and all humankind had he not followed Ie's unwise advice god, who is usually depicted as man's best friend. The myth begins with a description of Adapa as the wise son of Eridu, the most wise, a leader among open men. The skillful and exceedingly wise, the blameless and clean of hands, who daily provided Eridu, the city of Ie, with food and drink. One day, as Adapa set sail in the Persian Gulf to catch fish to provide Ie's sanctuary, the south wind blew up a gale and submerged him and his boat. Enraged, Adapa uttered a curse against the south wind and thus broke his wings. When the south wind had failed to blow upon the land for 7 consecutive days, the heaven god Anu inquired what the trouble was, and his vizier, Ilabrat, told him what had happened. Beside himself with anger, Anu rose from his throne and cried out, "Let them fetch him, Adapa, hither!" Here, Ie comes into the story and, unwittingly it seems, deprives Adapa and humankind of the gift they desire most, that of immortality. For the counsels Adapa thus, on his journey to heaven and Anu's palace, he wears his hair long and unkempt and dresses in mourning. This will arouse the curiosity of the two heavenly gatekeepers, Tammuz and Geshzida, two deities who had once lived on earth. Upon questioning him why he is mourning, Adapa is to answer them ingratiatingly that he is mourning two gods who had disappeared from the land. When they further ask him, who are the two gods who have disappeared from the land, he is to say, they are Tammuz and Geshzida. Delighted by this positive response, they will intercede for Adapa before the irate Anu. So far so good, however, Ie adds a bit of device which, intentional or not, turns out to be tragic for Adapa and humankind. This, in Ie's own words, runs, "As you stand before Anu, they will offer you the food of death. Do not eat it. They will offer you the water of death. Do not drink it." When Adapa arrives in heaven, garbed in mourning, and Tammuz and Geshzida, upon learning the purported reason for his mourning, intercede with Anu on his behalf, the latter offers not the food and water of death, but the food and water of Ur. Unfortunately, true to Ie's counsel, Adapa rejects both, and misses the golden opportunity to secure himself immortality and for humankind. Anu sends him back to earth, where man continues to be the victim of sickness and disease, although these can be allayed to some extent by Ninkarak, the goddess of healing and medicine. Another mortal who plays a significant role in an Akkadian myth is Itana, reputed to be a mighty ruler of the dynasty of Kish, the first after humankind had recovered from the legendary flood. He too ascended to heaven, but not, as with Adapa, to answer to the gods for a misdeed he had committed. He is burning, hope to obtain the plant of birth, For though he was a pious, God-fearing king who practiced the divine cult faithfully and assiduously, he was cursed with stupidity and had no one to carry on with his name. According to the myth, he is borne to heaven by an eagle, whom he had rescued from a pit where it had been cast by a serpent whose friend it had betrayed and whose nest it had devoured. The Inanna myth was popular among the seal cutters, to judge from several seals depicting a mortal climbing toward heaven on the wings of an eagle. The third Akkadian myth, in which a mortal plays a significant role, revolves about a sage named Atrahasis and his repeated efforts to save humankind from destruction at the hands of the gods angered by man's chronic depravity and evil doing. Unfortunately, only a few fragmentary passages of the composition, initially 1,245 lines, are preserved. From there, we gather that the gods, disturbed and depressed by the clamor of humanity, sent famine, plagues, pestilence, and disease against it so that people were reduced to cannibalism and self-destruction. Again and again, Atrahasis pleads with the god E to intercede, and humankind is saved, only to multiply once again and become noisy, rebellious, and clamorous. One of the decimating inflictions sent against man by the gods, according to this myth, is the flood, and in this case, man is saved when Atrahasis, on the advice of E, builds himself a big boat and boards it with his wife, family, and artisans, his grain, goods, and possessions, as well as the beasts of the field, as many as eat herbs. All this sounds like just another version of the well-known and not too different Sumerian, Akkadian, and Biblical flood stories, in which the hero's name, however, is not Atrahasis, Zeusudra, Utanapishtim, and Noah. Finally, there is a myth concerned with humankind's trials and tribulations of humankind, particularly the Akkadians. Though it ends on a note of hope and salvation, however, it is not a mortal but a god who acts as the savior of mankind. This myth, which is not readily accessible to the layman, will be treated here in considerable detail, since it is noteworthy in several respects. Its diction is highly poetic, some of its ideas and expressions seem to have biblical echoes. It ends with an unusual epilogue which illuminates, to some extent, the literary practices and conventions of the ancient myth writers. The two central protagonists of the myth are Ira, the god of pestilence, and his vizier and constant companion Isham, the god of fire. Following a description of Ira as the fearful slaughterer who always wastes the plain and who takes joyous delight in devastating the land, the story begins with Ira lying lazily about, uncertain of what is a cruel and destructive deed to perform next. At this point, Sibi, his strange and unnatural seven-bodied weapon, whose breath is death and which inspires all with dread and terror, speaks up to the signatory Ira in bitter anger. "Rise and march forth, Ira. Gods will hear and be dismayed. Kings will hear and be affrighted. The mighty will hear and quake. The towering mountains will hear and tremble, the billowy seas will hear and be consulted. Ira, here I have said my word. In the land I am a king, among the gods I am of the mighty Anunnaki, among the Agigi, heaven gods, I am valorous. Among the Anunnaki, here the netherworld gods, I am powerful. Because I am not feared, nor my utterance, and heeded the word of Marduk, but acted according to his own heart, I will arise Marduk, the princely, will summon him forth from his dwelling place, will destroy man." Thus, Ira proceeds to Erech, the city of Marduk, the king of the gods. He enters Marduk's temple, the Esagila, and urges Marduk to leave his dwelling place and go forth toward a place he describes as the house where the fire will purify your garments. Perhaps the mountain in the east where the gods live, or in the words of the poet, "Mighty Ira toward Erech, the city of the king of the gods, set his face, entered Esagila, the palace of heaven and earth, and stood before him, opened his mouth, and to the king of the gods speaks, 'Lord, the nimbus, the symbol of your lordship, full of brightness like a heavenly star. Darkened is its light. The crown of your lordship is cast down. March you forth from your dwelling place, toward the house where the fire will purify your garments. Set your face.'" Marduk is troubled lest, if he leaves Erech and the Esagila, complete chaos will fall on earth. Evil winds, demons, and the gods of the netherworld will destroy the land, devour its inhabitants, and destroy all living creatures, with none to turn them back. Ira reassures him he will take full charge while Marduk is away and see that the earth and its inhabitants are unharmed, either by the heaven gods or the netherworld demons. As soon as Marduk leaves Babylon, Ira calls Isham and says, "Open the path, I will take to the road. The day comes, the hour is past. I will speak, and the sun will drop its rays. I will cover with darkness the face of day. Who was born on a day of rain will be buried on a day of thirst. Who went forth on a well-watered path will return by a road of dust. I shall speak unto the king of the gods. Come not forth from the house you entered. Faithfully will I carry out your commands. When the black-headed people, the Akkadians, cry out to you, receive not their prayers. I will put an end to all habitations and turn them into mounds. I will devastate all the cities. Furthermore, make them into ruins. I will destroy the mountains and wipe out their flocks. I will console the seas and destroy their bounty. Furthermore, wipe out all living creatures." Isham is filled with pity for Ron, thus doomed to destruction. He therefore pleads with Ira to renounce his plans, but to no avail. He first destroyed Babylon and its inhabitants, as well as its walls and outskirts. Nippur, Arun, he turned to Erech, the city of Hierodules, courtesans, and sacred prostitutes, to whom Ishtar, the goddess of love, was husband and master. The city of Enochs and Sodomites, the merrymakers of Iruma, Ishtar's temple, whose maleness Ishtar had turned to femaleness, in order to terrify man. Erech, Arun, Ira still found no peace and rest, saying in his heart, "Who has made himself a house, saying, this is my resting chamber, this I have made to rest. The day the fates carry me off, I shall lie in its midst. I shall destroy his resting chamber after it had become a ruin. I shall give it to another." Isham, deeply disturbed, "Mighty Ira, by Ira's indiscriminate slaughter and destruction," pleads with him, and he tries to pacify him. Isham's address seems to pacify Ira to some extent, and proffer, at last, a note of hope, at least for the Akkadians, if not for humankind. Furthermore, the word which Isham spoke was soothing as oil, and thus did mighty Ira speak. "The Sealander, the Sealander, the Subterranean, the Sumerian, the Assyrian, the Assyrian, the Elamite, the Elamite, the Kassite, the Kassite, the Sutean, the Sutean, the Gutean, the Gutea, the Lulamere, the Lulamere, Landraland, city, city, house will attack the house, brother will not spare brother. Then will the Akkadian rise and subdue them all." Thus Ira at last finds peace and rest. He informs the gods that while he had formerly been angered by man's sins and had planned his destruction and annihilation, he recognized, because of Isham's counsel and urging, he will now see that the Akkadians defeat and conquer their enemies and carry off their booty to Mesopotamia, that the land will prosper in peace and not war, and that once again Shrupak will rule the world, or in Ira's own words to the happy Isham, "The people of the land, the few, will turn into many. The short and the tall will seek out its roads. The Akkadian, the weakling, will capture the sultan. The mighty one will carry off seven like sheep. His cities you will turn into ruins, his mountains to islands. His heavy booty you will carry off to Mesopotamia. The gods of the land, the irate, appeased you will bring them to their dwellings. Cattle and grain will prosper in the land. The fields which had been made desolate, you shall make to bear produce, and the governors, from the midst of their cities, will bring their tribute to Nibiru. The Akkur temples, which have been destroyed, like the rising sun, their peaks will shine forth in light. The Tigris and Euphrates, with waters of abundance, will overflow. Furthermore, in distant days, Nibiru will rule the cities." The poem closes with an epilogue that sheds some light on the psychological attitude of the author of the myth, as well as of the audience for whom it was intended. The first part reads, "That for the glory of Ira, the song might be sung years without count, how Ira had become angry, and had set his face to devastate the land, to lay down man and beast, how Isham his counsel had pacified him, and a remnant was saved. To Kabhani Madak, his tablet keeper, the son of Dabit, Isham showed it in a vision of the night. When he arose at dawn, not a line did he miss, and not a line did he add. To judge from the statement, which is hardly likely to have corresponded to the facts, the ancient myth writer deemed it essential to proclaim to his intended audience that he did not create the poem himself, but merely reproduced what a god had shown him in a vision. Nor is it unlikely that his claim was doubted by those who heard it. It might well be that the author himself was convinced of its truth. Our poet is keen to have his song endured through the ages, and to this end, he closes his epilogue. Ira heard and welcomed it. The song of Isham was pleasing to him. All the gods revered it with him. Furthermore, they did mighty Ira speak. Who honors this song in his sanctuary, abundance will overflow. Who causes it to be neglected will not smell incense. The king who exalts my name will rule the four quarters. The prince who utters the glory of my might will have no rival. The singer who chants it will not die in slaughter. To the prince and king his word will please. The scribe who learns it by heart will be saved from the enemy's land. In the assembly of the learned, where my name is honored unceasingly, I shall open wide the ears. To the house where this tablet is stored, should Ira be irate and Sibt rage, the wrath of Nibiru will come not near. Peace and well-being will be its lot. May the song exist for all time. May it endure unto eternity. All the land shall hear and revere my might. All the inhabited earth will say and exalt my name, Anunnaki of Nibiru.